amazing conference and for giving me the privilege to speak to you all today. In my first week of grad school, I gave a presentation to my new lab on TDCS, actually focusing on Vince Clark's paper using fMRI-guided TDCS to enhance learning. At that time, nobody in my lab had even heard of it. It says a lot about how far TDCS has come that 3 years later, my PhD advisor, Art Kramer, came to me and asked me to help write the TDCS section of a grant for this wildly ambitious cognitive training project. This project is the InSight Project, and it's funded by a generous grant from IARPA. Now, to give you an idea of the scale of this project, we just finished collecting data for phase 1A a few weeks ago, and we ran 518 subjects, half of whom completed a two-hour MRI pre- and post-training. Now, we had five groups, including an active and sham TDCS group, as well as three control groups. Subjects completed a 16-week intervention with three 70-minute sessions every week. This means we ended up running over 9,200 training sessions, of which 2,600 were TDCS sessions. In those sessions, we administered over 600 hours of high-definition TDCS at 2 milliamps. So this is, to my knowledge, the biggest TDCS study ever done. Now, the full project name is An Integrative System for Enhancing Fluid Intelligence Through Human Cognitive, Physical Fitness, HDTDCS, and Nutritional Intervention. If you're wondering where we got InSight from, trust me, it's in there. Sometimes an acronym works right out of the box, sometimes you have to make it work. So the goal of the project was to try and identify synergistic effects of exercise and cognitive training on fluid intelligence. There's a pretty wide literature showing benefits of exercise and cognitive training on cognition. We wanted to see if combining these gave you something greater than the sum of its parts. So a lot of the work showing the benefits of exercise on cognition comes from my own lab, supervised by Art Kramer, who's shown that aerobic exercise benefits cognition with both behaviorally, looking at executive function and working memory, and also using structural imaging, showing greater hippocampal volume following an exercise intervention. For the InSight project, we chose an exercise intervention that combines both aerobic and strength training. We're not supposed to call it CrossFit, but it's a lot like CrossFit. It's a very rigorous exercise intervention. Now for cognitive training, we teamed up with a video game developer called Aptima to develop a brain training game for Android tablet. We went with a Wild West theme and we called it Mind Frontiers. Now, the goal of the cognitive training game was to be adaptive and engaging. Adaptive difficulty is critical to an effective cognitive training intervention. And having a game that's kind of fun and people actually want to play goes a long way as well. So we ended up with six mini games, which I'll discuss a little bit later. So in the first month of the intervention, participants just did the exercise intervention. The idea for this was to kind of prime the brain for learning. In month two, we started phasing in the cognitive training. So participants in month two would do two exercise sessions a week and one cognitive training session. In month three, that flipped around. So in months three and four, participants would do two cognitive training sessions a week and one exercise session every week. This comes out to a total of 20 one-hour cognitive training sessions. Now I mentioned that we had five groups. This included a no-contact control group, as well as an active control group that played a series of adaptive visual search and change detection mini-games that I actually got to program. As a lifelong gamer, I was really excited I finally got to make a video game, even if it was incredibly dull. For the purposes of today's talk, I'm going to focus on the active and sham groups. Now, we started with about 100 subjects per group and ended up with about 60. Now, 40% is an incredibly high attrition rate, but it was comparable across both groups, and it had to do largely with the exercise intervention. We had, let's call it a largely sedentary population at the start of the study, many of whom just didn't exercise before the intervention. In all seriousness, we had a few subjects whose weight we couldn't measure because the scales at the fitness center just didn't go that high. And those tended to be the subjects who dropped out from the exercise intervention. So for our HDTDCS intervention, we administered 2 milliamps of high-definition TDCS for 30 minutes at the start of each cognitive training session. Participants would start playing the cognitive training games once stimulation had ramped up to full. We used a 2x2 bilateral prefrontal electrode montage meant to stimulate the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. We worked closely with Lucas Parra and Soteric to decide on this montage. We provided Soterix with M&I coordinates of the regions we wanted to stimulate, and they came up with this montage to achieve maximum intensity in these regions. We chose the prefrontal regions because of the critical importance of the DLPFC to fluid intelligence, and also because of our own pilot research, in which we found that playing mind frontiers in an fMRI machine led to consistent prefrontal activation. For our sham protocol, we used a 30-second ramp up, 30 seconds, 30-second ramp down procedure, with an additional ramp up, ramp down at the end of the 30 minutes. This sham proved to be very effective, and subjects were at chance at guessing if they were inactive or sham. Here's a subject running station all ready to go, with an EasyCap outfitted with Soterix's 3D printed electrode holders. Here is what came to be known as the Great Wall of Batteries. This is how many batteries it took to run all the TDCS sessions. At the height of subject running, we were running 16 sessions at the same time from 9 to 5. So I'll start off by going over the cognitive training results. I'll talk about each game in turn. Sentry Duty was our dual NBAC game. You can't hear it right now, but there are audio cues. As they lift the lanterns, they're saying Alpha, Charlie, Delta. And your job is to respond if the visual, audio, or both cues match the one presented N targets ago. So here you see average performance across all 20 sessions. The blue line represents the sham TDCS group, and the red line is active TDCS. And you'll see we were able to achieve a statistically significant benefit of TDCS on performance on our dual NVAC sentry duty game. Our next game is Irrigator. This is a pipe building game that has you connect a water source to various wells. This game relies on planning and problem solving. On later difficulties, you have to connect it to even more wells and navigate around more obstacles. We were unable to show a significant group difference on this game, but there was a clear trend for increased performance of the active TDCS group. In Anti-Up, your job is to make your stack on the bottom look like the one on the top in as few moves as possible. This is our version of the Tower of London or the Tower of Hanoi task. It's actually surprisingly fun. This ended up being participants' favorite game. Unfortunately, we were unable to show a group difference on this task. Now, this is probably because of a flaw in the game design. Based on the literature, they generally use Tower of London tasks that require up to 8 or 9 moves. So we programmed in up to 15 moves. But it turns out over the course of 20 sessions, a lot of the participants got past that. So we had to impose a ceiling on the data, which limited variability substantially. Riding Shotgun was our game of visuospatial memory span. It's kind of like the Simon game that I had as a kid, where they would show you a sequence and you have to recreate it. And the sequence would get longer on harder difficulties. As it turns out, there's not a lot of room for improvement when it comes to memory span. Participants tended to reach their ceiling in the first few sessions, then not improve much after that. Despite the ceiling, we still showed a clear benefit of anhedonic TDCS compared to sham. This effect looks even better if you limit the axis range, but the ANOVA results don't change. In Supply Run, this is our game of memory update. So in Supply Run, you come across townsfolk who ask you to get them supplies that fall into various categories. And your job is to remember the most recent item from each category. On higher difficulties, the number of categories and also the number of requests increases. At the end of each game, you come to a general store, at which point you have to pick out the items that you had to remember. Performance was fairly variable on Supply Run, and we weren't able to show quite a significant effect, but there's still a clear trend for enhanced performance of the active TDCS group. Pen 'em Up was our task switching game, in which you have to sort stimuli based on certain rules, and then switch between different rules. So in this game, the subject is alternating between sorting based on animal or tree and sorting based on single or double. In Pen 'em Up, we were able to show a clear benefit of active TDCS on performance. So to sum up, we were able to show enhanced performance on 3 of the 6 cognitive training games with fairly clear trends for 2 of the 3 remaining games. This effect tended to be stronger in later sessions. So I would call this a success, but this wasn't really the result we were going for. Dr. Parasurman yesterday mentioned the importance of transfer. And in cognitive training, transfer is the end result that you want to get. You're not trying to improve performance on things that you train on. You want to improve performance on things you don't train on. Specifically, we wanted to improve performance on fluid intelligence. Now, we use multiple measures to assess fluid intelligence, including the BOMAT task, which is very similar to the Raven's Advanced Progressive Matrices task, in which we present you a stimuli that follows certain rules, and your job is to fill in the blanks. It's widely regarded as the gold standard in fluid intelligence. Our other fluid intelligence tasks relied on similar cognitive abilities of pattern recognition, problem solving, and inductive reasoning, but with letter and number patterns. It was F, by the way. Here you see performance on the BOMAT task. Now, the first thing you might notice is that there are slight baseline differences between the active group on the left and the sham group on the right. These differences were non-significant, and in all analyses, we co-varied for baseline score. Now, the second thing you might notice is that both groups seem to improve about the same amount, and indeed, we weren't able to show a significant group difference in terms of transfer to the BOMAT. Looking at number series, again, we were unable to show a significant group difference. And the same is true of letter sense. So, in the end, we weren't able to show an effect of TDCS on transfer to fluid intelligence. Now, we also assessed multiple other constructs with multiple measures per construct, ranging from working memory to executive function. And we were unable to show a reliable effect of TDCS on any of these constructs. Only a few other studies have combined TDCS with cognitive training, and our results are actually fairly consistent with theirs. Two recent studies had participants train for 10 sessions on either a dual NBAC task or a working memory task while receiving annual TDCS to F3. And in both cases, TDCS enhanced performance on the trained task, but neither study was able to show differences between the active and sham group on untrained transfer tasks, just like us. So to sum up, anecdotal TDCS ended up enhancing performance on the cognitive training game, but it had no reliable effect on transfer. So what does it mean to enhance training without enhancing transfer? What happened here? Well, one explanation is that TDCS may have somehow modulated task-specific networks so selectively that it didn't affect the underlying cognitive abilities. Another explanation has to do with vigilance. Nelson and colleagues recently showed that administering anecdotal TDCS to F3 enhanced both behavioral and physiological measures of vigilance. Given that our montage included F3, it's possible that we inadvertently ended up enhancing vigilance, thereby improving performance on the cognitive training tasks during stimulation. This would also explain the results of the two studies I mentioned earlier. So, future directions of the InSight project, we're going to be adding new interventions. In phase 1B, which starts in a few months, we're adding a mindfulness meditation training intervention. Phase 2 will add a nutrition intervention, kind of a brain-building vitamin milkshake. And we'll also be making improvements to the Mind Frontiers game. We're going to be adding sort of Farmville, SimCity-esque metagame, where playing the minigame earns you sawbucks, which you can use to spend on wild little buildings for your Wild West town. But lastly, and most importantly, we will not be including TDCS in future phases of the segment. If it were up to me, we would have a cathodal group, we would have separate montages for each game, for different levels of training, but I don't get to make those decisions. We've heard a lot of talk about the hype curve, and the consensus seems to be that we're somewhere around here. A part of this process is discovering not only the potential of TDCS, but also its limitations. Based on the data collected in the InSight project, I suggest that one of those limitations may be that TDCS is perhaps better suited to training specific skills than generalizable ones. I'd like to thank Soterix and IARPA and all of the members of the InSight project.